Everyone looks about 5% larger, so it looks like y'all had a great Thanksgiving. Hey, I have an exciting announcement about the Christmas ball today. It should be a slide up here for it. It's coming up next Saturday, December 9th, and it's actually going to be from 7:30 to 10:30. So it's going to be 3 hours instead of the 9:30 on the slide. We'll get that fixed. But I do want to let you know that this will be the last week to get RSVP'd and get your tickets bought, so that way we can start getting the meal ready and get all our supplies ready for everything we need. So get RSVP'd this week. The information for that is in your email. Now give it up for Bill Thomas.
Thank you. Thank you, Lucas. How's everybody doing? I'm excited to share with you a little bit today. Come Friday, Saturday, Sunday of this week, a special event's happening here at Central. It's a ministry that I've been involved in for over 40 years. That's a long time. But National Bible Bowl is coming here. There'll be over 300 people here on campus beginning around noon on Friday, and they'll be here till Sunday afternoon. There'll be 150 junior high and high school kids that'll be on our campus. They've been studying the book of Exodus, chapters 1 to 15. They're here to compete for their national tournament, and it's an exciting time for them, but it's a great opportunity for us here at Central, too. We have an opportunity to demonstrate what our community is about. I want to let you know that they'll be in the Pelfrey building here, using all the rooms starting Friday afternoon, a little bit in the library. The library will be closed on Saturday. The stew will be open like normal, so that won't be any difference in the stew. Be sure you're aware of that. And the weight room is going to be open like normal, so if you use the weight room, that'll be there. But I just wanted to say thank you on behalf of the Bible people for being able to host this event. It's going to be a great thing for the students. It's going to be a great thing for our community, too. And I want to challenge you to be sure to get an opportunity to meet some of these kids. Let them see you. Let them envision themselves being a part of our Central community. A lot of these kids will be going to Bible college, and they might as well go to college right here. So you have an opportunity to impact them. Most of the time when we travel to other campuses, the students aren't there, so we don't see the students. But we will get a chance to visit with you. So I encourage you to if you see them, to be friendly, to let them know how great it is here. And you're welcome to come to any of the games, the matches. They're about 20 minutes long, and they'll be running from Friday afternoon till Sunday afternoon. So if you come into Pelfrey, you get a chance to see them. And some of you have seen it before. It's kind of impressive how they study the scriptures. If you haven't had a chance to see it, be sure you do. So again, thank you, and make good use of the opportunity to encourage these kids. And now I want to turn it over to Professor Walt Harper.
Hey, I am looking for some individuals who are driven by curiosity and adventure and excitement to travel to the other side of the world and do an archaeological excavation with me. In the ancient village of Shekin, you had an email that went out before break that had an application to sign up for a scholarship to help pay for that trip. I need, if you are interested in being a part of that this next summer, I need you to fill out this application, because that goes through an interview process for the scholarship. And it's a wonderful opportunity. You'll get a field certificate in archaeology. You'll travel to some amazing places in the Bible land, learn a whole lot of really fun stuff, and be a part of digging up stuff that will end up in museums. Does that sound cool, to see your stuff in a museum? Does that sound pretty awesome? You can have the opportunity to be part of something like that. Hope you sign up. And while I have the cup in my hand, also, there's a lot of you that just haven't signed up for Philosophy of Family Ministry to go to the Orange Conference with me. Do that too, all right?
Thanks, Professor Harper. Good morning, church. Are we ready? Is everybody into the holiday spirit yet? I can see you're super excited about it. It's just so exciting to be in the midst of the holiday spirit. Would you guys stand up and let's prepare ourselves for worship today? Let's start with a word of prayer. Father God, thank you so much for your grace and mercy, so liberally gifted to us, Father. I pray your blessing, Father, not only on the opportunity we have to worship and to join together as a community in worshiping you, but also, Father, from hearing about your word and getting a commission to be grateful people. We love you, Father, and we praise you for all of the gifts you give us. In Christ's name, amen.
right, good morning, everyone. We're excited to worship with you today, but now I'm ready. Sorry.
Before I call, before I ever cry, you answer me from where the thunder hides. I can't outrun this heart I'm tethered to. Every step I collide with you, like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing into me. Your love is fierce, like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. Your love is fierce. You cannot fail. Never let me down. You don't hold back, relentless in pursuit. At every turn, I come face to face with you. Oh, like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing into me. Your love. Tearing through the atmosphere, your love is fierce. Your love is fierce.
You chase me down, you seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? Chase me down, you seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down, you seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down, you seek me out. Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing into me. Your love is fierce, like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce, like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing into me, your love is fierce, like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere, your love is fierce, your love is fierce, your love.
So as a lot of you know, we were at ICOM. Right before we went to Thanksgiving break, there was a group of students that went to ICOM, and we had an awesome worship team there, CCV Music, and they write some of their own songs. They're a church out in Arizona. And one of their songs is called Glory to the One, and it comes straight out of Revelation 4:11, where it says, "Worthy are you, our Lord and our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and because of your will, they existed and were created. And so as we sing this song today, it might be new to you, and if it is, then listen to the words. It's really not a hard one to pick up, and so whenever you feel comfortable to jump in, please sing, and if you know it, then obviously please sing with us today. Thank you.
He always got pray. Dear Lord, I thank you so much for this day and for giving us another opportunity to worship together and to come together in fellowship. And I know we're all going through a lot. We're stressed about school and about Christmas break and personal things. And so, God, I pray that today during chapel that we would be able to fix our minds on you and look to you for our comfort and our strength and our hope. And I pray a blessing over Pastor Bobby today and his sermon, and that we would be encouraged by his message. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks to our worship team for bringing a little bit of ICOM back to us. And if you were at ICOM, I know you had the chance to enjoy that as well. It was a great convention and good to see so many people there from Central and people who have gone out from Central to serve in various parts of the world. It really was exciting to be there. We're continuing this semester's series of sermons on gifts. And we've finished a set of sermons by different alumni who have shared about how they were able to use God's gift for his glory. Now we're going to have two more sermons, one for Thanksgiving and one for Christmas, on two gifts that God has given us that we should maximize all year long. And today, because we just finished celebrating Thanksgiving, we'll be looking at the gift of thankfulness. And then next week we'll have somebody to talk about a different gift. But I want to introduce you to our speaker today, Pastor Bobby Godwin from Central Christian Church here in Moberly, Missouri. Now, Pastor Bobby has come a long ways from his days on the college football field playing for Missouri State University, or as it was known back then, Southwest Missouri State University, where he was a Bear. And I grew up in Southwest Missouri, so I rooted for the Bears. Didn't even know that I was rooting for him at the time. But he would have been a good guy to root for. He graduated with a business degree from there and really had a career not in the ministry but in a variety of different realms until prayer and encouragement of other people got him pointed towards the ministry. And there's a lot I could tell you about Pastor Bobby's ministry journey. He may share some of that as part of his sermon today. But the one thing I would like you to know about Pastor Bobby is that he is a man of prayer. And when you've been prayed for by Pastor Bobby, you know you've been prayed for. There is no doubt that he has prayed for you. When our very own Janelle Owen was immobilized in the hospital, I was told by Janelle to keep everything quiet, don't talk about it, it was going to be okay. And so I just, you know, didn't post anything, didn't share anything. Next thing you know, Pastor Bobby's posting something called "Everybody Needs to Pray for Janelle Now." And he starts going to town on prayer. And I'll tell you what, it's a good thing he did because the prayers worked. And I contacted Bobby to confirm that it was true. And he said yes. And just one of many illustrations of times in Bobby's life when he has just showed up to pray and a difference has been made. I know you're going to love hearing him speak today. Would you join me in welcoming Pastor Bobby Godwin?
Okay. Thank you so much. Technical. I'm not the most technical person in the whole place, but hey, God bless you. It's so good to see you. A lot of friendly faces, some faces I've seen before, and so glad to be back here in the house to just give you a word of encouragement. I discovered probably 10 years ago, and I was, well, 12 years ago, I turned 40, y'all, and so the light bulb came on for me. I was like, God, I've lived 57% of my life. I don't know what my purpose is, what you're calling for my life, what it's that you'd have me do. And I took a spiritual gifts assessment, and it said you have the gift of exhortation. Anybody know what that is? I didn't. I was like, what's gift of exhortation? It said, well, you're an encourager. An encourager. I was like, I've been that dude my whole life. I've always walked through the factory, high-fiving and fist-bumping. Hey, how'd the Suns game? Did y'all win? What was the score? You know, I've been that dude my whole life. I said, now that I know that's my gift, I'm going to be even more over the top with my gift. So when Coach Janelle had what he had going on, I was like, there's no way that I'm going to let that happen. God, you got to use my gift of encouragement to encourage others to get involved. And for some of you that know this, but way back in the 1900s, there used to be, before the WWE and the WWF and all that kind of stuff, there were some characters like Junkyard Dog and Hacksaw Jim Duggan and all those people. And I just envisioned with Janelle being down for the count, it's like they had drug him, the sickness had drug him out in the middle of the ring, and that guy was climbing up to the top rope like to jump off and do the big belly splash. And you guys know what makes wrestling so exciting is the dude, his friends will come running down that big ramp to help and slide underneath the rope and, you know, and get the guy off. And I felt like, hey, man, that's exactly what needs to happen. I just want to give you a visual that when we get down, God is going to say to us, listen, I'm not going to let anything or anyone stop you from the destiny, the purpose, the calling I have for your life. I'm going to send in some resources. He's like, Pastor Bobby, like, you haven't even prayed or nothing. Like, what are you doing? I'm sorry. I'm sorry. But God's going to send some resources to come in and help you, and I'm so grateful for God and what he's done. So Pastor, for Dr. Fincher and the staff and folks here that are living your life to make a difference, thank you for the investment that you're making in students. I had an opportunity to speak here at Rotary Club, and one of the things that I spoke on then was the five most important men in my life. The five most important men in my life. Like, who were those people? Who were the people that took the time to invest in me? And it's a whole different ball game when I'm looking at my life from 18 versus looking at my life from 52. Like, who were those five people that made the greatest difference in my life? So today, what I want to talk to you about is about the gift of Thanksgiving, the gift of Thanksgiving. And we're going to look at a story found here in Luke chapter 17. But before we do, we want to have a word of prayer. Father, we do bless you. Thank you so much for your goodness, your mercy, your grace, your compassion, your love for us. We pray that in all that we do, that we be careful to give you the praise, to give you the glory, to give you the honor, to give you thanks for your goodness and mercy and compassion towards us, your favor that you have bestowed upon us, Lord, your willingness to get in the middle of our conditions and situations and cause things to be turned around. Your word that says in Acts 2:21 that all who call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So, Father, we thank you that you have ears to hear and a heart of concern and compassion for us, that you want to see our lives made new and our lives transformed. So at the few moments that I have speaking here today, would you cause these words to be uplifting and encouraging to the students and staff here. In the mighty and precious name of Jesus, we thank you for it. Amen and amen. So we'll be in Luke chapter 17, beginning at verse 11. And these words say, now it happened as Jesus, went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Verse 12 says, and then he entered a certain village, and there met him 10 men who were lepers who stood afar off. Verse 13 says, they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Verse 14 says, so when he had saw them, he said to them, go show yourselves to the priest. So it was that they went. As they went, they were cleansed. Verse 15 says, and one of them, when he saw he was healed, he returned with a loud voice, glorifying God. He fell down on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks, and he was a Samaritan. Verse 17 says, and so Jesus answered and said, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Verse 18, were there not any found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner? And he said unto him, arise, go your way. Your faith has made you well. Go your way, your faith has made you well. So here's an example of an individual that is Jesus creates an encounter with. I believe that in this case where Jesus is traveling, the Bible says, from Jerusalem, He's going into the midst of a village in Samaria and Galilee that Jesus knew that when he got to where he was going to, there were going to be individuals that he would find in that place that would want and need everything that he would have to give them. And I'm sorry for touching my phone, but I know if I start preaching and I don't start a clock, there's going to be a problem. So Jesus, I imagine as he and his disciples, they head towards this village, and they're going there, that all the time Jesus is going, and he's just not going to the village, and he's to a Samaritans and to Galilee, because he's just going for no reason, but ultimately he's going to this village because he knows there's going to be a need that when he gets to that village, he's going to put himself in a position where the need, the desire to be healed can meet the healer. And I don't know about you, but let's just say Jesus was coming into Mobile, Missouri. And depending on where you students come here to college from, you can come from the north, the south, the east, or the west. But one way that I guarantee that you'll have to come in is from Highway 63 or Highway 24, unless you live out in the sticks. You don't have to touch one of those highways to get in this city. And it says that Jesus, as he is entering the city, he enters the city and he enters in a place where those 10 lepers could stop and say, look, I think that's Jesus and his disciples. They start to count. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Oh, there's 13. There's 13. Oh, I bet you it's Jesus. It says, let us get a little bit closer. As they got a little bit closer to the city, the village that they weren't allowed to go into, there was an eye contact situation, and all of a sudden, all 10 lepers got in unison, and they shouted, Jesus, have mercy on us. They shouted, Jesus, have mercy on us. And Jesus could have done what he done with that Syrophoenician woman that said, hey, listen, I got a daughter that's demon-possessed. And will you help me? And the Bible says that Jesus didn't say anything to the woman. And I can kind of relate to that Syrophoenician woman because I got 4 daughters, and I think every single one of them, when they became teenagers, something happened. If you got daughters, say amen. Something happened, but Jesus didn't ignore the cry of the 10 lepers. He didn't ignore their cry. He tells them to do something that they were never allowed to do. He said, go show yourselves to the priest. And the 10 lepers, they turn. They start going to show themselves to the priest. And all of a sudden, they begin to look at their skin and their fingers. In every place that their skin was dried and broken and itchy, and some of the digits of their hands had fallen off, and I imagine toes and feet were viewed through sandals, and the toes that had fallen off, something happened, and toes began to grow back, and skin began to clear up, and one of the 10 lepers who noticed that there's a transformation that happened to me, I believe his name was Bobby. I believe that was his name. That's who it's going to be today for this message. I believe his name was Bobby. All of a sudden, Bobby looks at himself. Bobby looks at himself. He said, oh my goodness. Hey man, look at my skin. Hey, my pinky that was messed up with football is cut up. Well, it's still kind of messed. But anyway, it's healed. It's grown back. Look, my skin. Oh, my goodness. Look at me. All of my skin is healed up. And I imagine the other 9 lepers were just like everybody else. They said, hey, bro, what are you doing? I said, I'm going back. They said, no. He said, go show yourself to the priest. And oftentimes when we get in religion, We'll want to follow a course and keep the commands, not understanding that this Jesus is a personal and intimate Jesus that wants us. And instead of them listening to the voice, the nine voices say, hey, bro, you're going to mess us up, man. What if he takes the blessing back? We're all healed, but we're not going back to say thank you. Come with us. He said, go tell the, show yourself to the priest. It's just Bobby's version. Y'all ain't going to find it. I'm sorry. Go show yourself to the priest. Instead of them doing what he done and turning around like he turned around, it says they kept on going. And I imagine this Bobby dude ran back to Jesus. And I imagine his heart was so filled with thanks. But as Jesus and his disciples continued on into the village, imagine Jesus had other business there. But I imagine the screams of thank you and adoration that this one man had got Jesus' disciples' attention. And Jesus takes him from this place. He says, listen, of them being cleansed, to them being healed, and now this one that's returned to give Jesus thanks, he says, you're going to be made whole. And in my life, there's been some conditions, Faith, that I've run into in life. And I say, God, this can't be you. Why is there so much trouble in my life? God, you're supposed to be a faithful, loving, compassionate God. God, you see what they're doing to me in corporate America. God, this isn't right. I helped build this organization. And God, look at what they're doing to me. What are you doing, God? The leprosy got over my heart of gratitude. And I had to get in this place where God had to speak to me and said, son, this is what I want you to do. I just want you to take out a sheet of paper, a blank sheet. I said, yes, God. I want you to begin to write the things that you're thankful for. Well, God, I start with the five most important people in your life. Who are they? Well, my football coach. Well, what did he do for you? Well, I'm thankful for Coach God. Well, what did he do? Well, he took our little town from being like a 0-10 every year town to being 10-0, and colleges started coming and looking, and they discovered me and discovered my brother and went to play football at OU. I'm thankful for him. Oh, so you, what's the possibilities of that happening coming from a family like you grow up in where you've got five brothers and four sisters and both of your parents are born in the 1920s that grew up in segregated schools and the only jobs that they were allowed to have because of segregation was the job of a cleaner or a cook. There was no financial means for you to even go to college. Would you say you're thankful for my provision to provide you a full ride scholarship to come to Southwest Missouri State back in the 1900s and receive a full ride scholarship to play football? Wouldn't you say you're thankful for that? Long story short, I begin to look at everything in my life, the things that I'm thankful for in my health, the things that I'm thankful for in my family, the things that I'm thankful for with all the career path that God had taken me through up to this point where 32 years old, I'm working at a factory out in the middle of wheat fields where Southwest Airlines and US Air and Continental, they would take the engines off and send them out to us and we would disassemble every single bit of the engine and fix all the pieces and reassemble it. And sometimes they would bring the planes in, we would put them on and do ground runs and the planes would fly off and disappear in the crowd. And this guy who's now got leprosy over his heart of gratitude is looking back and saying, listen, maybe it was because I was so good, but God, it wasn't my goodness. It was your grace and mercy that gave me the responsibility of having $250 million worth of business that I was responsible for as a guy at 32. God, I'm grateful. I didn't deserve any of that. And so what God is wanting us to know and understand, that this guy that came back to Jesus, and it says that he gave glory to God, and he shouted with a loud voice, I believe is because he had a good memory. I love the way this passage starts off because it talks about there were men who were lepers. And who knows what their lives were like before they were actually became lepers. Who knows if they were college students that had graduated and started in the ministry and had started with a family, and had a couple children, and now all of a sudden their life has been interrupted by leprosy that basically ostracized them from even coming into the city. They were on the outskirts crying out to Jesus, screaming with a loud voice. And my point to every single one of you is this: maybe this one that returned remembered everything that he lost. As he's running back to Jesus, and as he's crying with a loud voice, and he's falling on his feet, maybe he's thinking, now I'll be able to go back into God's house and worship. Now I'll be able to return to my wife and my children. Now I'll be able to return to the job that I lost. We don't know why he was so grateful, but the fact of the matter is, God wants you and I to know and recognize that we have to be grateful for everything that he's given us. And this guy, because he turned to say thank you, because he turned to glorify God, Jesus says, listen, I'm not just going to give you what everybody else has. He says, I'm going to give you wholeness. And I believe that in every aspect of the person's mind, like we can have something going on in our body, and our body can be healed, but our mind could still be worrying, and we could still have depression, and we can still have anxiety, and we can still have stress, and we can still have fears. And Jesus probably looking at this guy who turned around and say, thank you. He said, I've healed your leprosy. You are cleansed now. Now you can go and show yourself to the priest, but I'm going to do something for you that you didn't ask for. I'm going to heal these other aspects of your life that maybe you don't even think about anymore. Maybe there's anxieties and depressions and different things that are interfering with your love relationship with God. And Jesus, in that moment, I don't know what the wholeness was for this guy, but in that moment, Jesus gave him the things that he didn't ask for. And so for us in this room, the question becomes for us, it's like, how do we get here? What are the things that we're thankful for? Can we remember all the things that we're thankful for? And I was writing in the front of my note says, God was instructing me to write down the things that I was thankful for, and I fill that whole front of the page up. Every career opportunity that God had given me up to that point, and how God had given me a heart to get involved with youth football, and how God had made it possible for us to raise $10,000 to start a youth football program in Slater, how God had made it possible for me now to be the high school football coach in Slater with no experience. I was like, guys, listen, I'm a factory person. You need a sideline person with no experience. How God had made it possible for us to win our first game in 4 years. And I don't know about you, but when I sat down and I began to thank God for all the things that he'd done in my life, everything that I thought was a problem, everything that I thought was a big deal for me, it paled in comparison to all of the things that God has done in my life. And I don't know, I venture to say that all of us in this room, we've had issues and we had times and seasons where we've all totally forgotten about the wonderful things that God's done for us. I think about my middle daughter, Jessica, who's a student in Ozark Technical College, and she works at Lambert's Home of the Throat Roll. And she was born a hefty 10 pounds and 8 ounces. And how desperately the doctors worked on her because she was so hard to be delivered. And how it was 3 minutes before she took her first breath. I think about when she was probably 3 years old or four, we returned home and we're attending a church service, and an uncle gave her a quarter. And she put it in her mouth and swallowed the quarter. and her face began to turn blue. And how we rushed her to Tulsa to have something that they stick down her throat and to get that quarter out, and she wasn't harmed at all. What am I saying? I'm saying that faith requires us to have a good memory. Faith requires us to have a good memory. We don't know why this guy turned around, why he came back rejoicing the way he did, but he has a reason. And if you stop and you think like God had me to stop and think, what would you do without your vision? Are you thankful for that? What would you do if you couldn't hear? Are you thankful for that? What if you couldn't breathe properly? What if you couldn't stand up and walk? What would you do without these basic functions that I've given you? Aren't you thankful for that? And so when I became grateful and thankful for, started writing all those things down, God spoke to my heart and said, listen, this is what I want you to understand. That the condition that you're facing right now, it pales in comparison to whatever else it is that God's done in your life. And he wants us all to be grateful. He wants us to be thankful. To be like this one leper, to be the one, the Bobby, that decided to turn around and go back and fall at the feet of Jesus because he knew with this compassion, with this mercy, with this grace that Jesus was demonstrating towards him that everything that he lost in life had now been restored. And I believe that's what God wants me and you to do, to stop and to look at our lives and say, hey, what would my life be without Jesus involved with it? What would my life be without my faith journey? Who are the people that God's brought into my life to help me fulfill the destiny, calling, and purpose that he has for my life? If I could give any bit of encouragement to you listening to this message, is don't wait till you're 40 and go to God and say, God, I've lived 57% of my life. What's your purpose for me? And with God, I said, God, I've had these goals and these dreams and this plan, and this is what I wanted to accomplish in corporate America, and these were my goals and these were my dreams. And God said, son, listen, I've got goals and dreams for you. I said, yes, God, yes. I want your goals and I want your dreams. Whatever it is, it's 10 times, a billion times better than mine. God, what is it you want me to do? He said, son, I want you to begin to give your life away. Resurrect your football gift. I didn't know it was a gift. Resurrect your football gift. Make it possible for little boys and little girls to play football. And right now we've got 154 boys and girls that are fond of this Mobile Little Spartan Football League, but we've got 800 football players that I'm responsible for in the North Central Youth Football League. And it all started with this moment, this encounter with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, to say, listen, what is it that you have in store for my life? We don't know the rest of this guy's story, but I'm almost certain that his life was transformed after this moment that he had with Jesus. Can I just ask God's blessing on you? Would you please stand with me? I just want to pray over you if I can do that. Am I allowed to do that? Come on, let's stand. Please stand. I want to ask God's blessing on you. So, Father, do thank you so much for this moment that we had to spend in your word, to look at this one leper, God, who returned, who gave thanks to you. And we simply want to be those people that we want to see you, God, transform our lives, to make all things new, to use this gift of thankfulness, to say thank you, Lord, for all the wonderful things that you've done for us. The big things and the small things, we're asking in the mighty and precious name of Jesus that from this moment on, you would remove every distraction, every interference, that you would cause us to get alone with you and get quiet before you, God, just to give you thanks for the abundance of mercies and compassions that you pour out on us. We thank you, God, for your son, Jesus. We thank you for his life being sacrificed on Calvary's cross to save us from our sins. We thank you that in his name, Yeshua, Jehovah is salvation, that in his name every aspect of our life can be transformed and be made new. And so, Father, we are thanking you that we have this opportunity to encounter Jesus in this moment, to cause our lives to be made new in every way. So we bless you, God, we honor you, and we give you thanks, Father, for the wonderful things that you're going to do in us and through us. Let us leave this place knowing that we are to be grateful and thankful to you. We are to turn to you and say, God, we're thankful for this opportunity to be students here at Central Christian College of the Bible. We're thankful, Father, for this opportunity to love you and serve you and train the next generation to be worship leaders and pastors and preachers and missionaries. And God, we ask in the name of Jesus that your choice blessings would be poured out on this place. God, every need that this college has, the wisdom and knowledge and understanding that's needed to lead this place, God, the generosity that's needed to be poured out on this place, God, that everything that you have, your goals, your dreams for this institution can be established in the mighty and precious name of Jesus. So, Father, bless these students, bless this faculty, bless this staff. God, all that they touch in this place, would you cause their hands to prosper in Jesus' mighty and precious name? We give you thanks for it, God, and we thank you for all the love that you've demonstrated for us. And everybody that loved Jesus said, amen and amen. God bless you guys. Thank you for letting me come speak.
Amen. Amen. Praise Jesus for that wonderful story, that testimony. Let's sing of his greatness today, like you mentioned there at the end of that prayer.
There was a
God, we come before you today so thankful for this opportunity to give you praise. Help us to hail your name as we walk throughout today, as we walk throughout this week and the rest of our lives, God. Help us to serve you, to love you, and to grow closer to you every day. In your name we pray. Amen.
Hey, if you'll have a seat for just a minute, I want to share a couple of things with you. First of all, really appreciate Pastor Bobby for coming today. I knew that he could preach. I knew that he could pray. I had no idea he could sing. Having him standing behind me, hearing him sing was great. So he was putting everything into it today. And if you appreciated what Pastor Bobby had to share, would you give him an appreciation? You know, he was speaking about reflecting back to what God had done earlier in his life and us having a good memory. And it prompted a thought in my mind that I want to share with you to think about today. When I was a college student here back in 1989 to 2023, I came here to be a worship minister. And what I really wanted to do was have a church where I could lead worship. And I couldn't find a single church to lead worship. I don't know if I was, you know, not good enough or ahead of my time or not looking hard enough for what it was. But anyway, I didn't get to do that. What I got to do instead was go out for the college on weekend trips singing and visiting lots of churches that supported the college and spending lots of time with Mr. Pelfrey, who was the president then, and watching a guy who had been the president by that point for about 20 years do what he did so well in visiting with people that supported the school and stand up in front of people and help lead the songs and sing specials and occasionally preach. And I've reflected through the years how that was pretty good preparation for what I do right now. It was a great opportunity to meet some of the same people. Many of them remember me from then that are supporters of the college and have a care for what we do here paramount in their lives. And the thing that I thought I was just doing to get through college might have actually been the very thing that God used later to do what he wanted me to. And I don't know what that is for you. I don't know what area of service or relationship or activity you see yourself in and go, why am I doing this? What is God doing with this time in my life? But keep your memories. Someday that memory will mean a lot to you, and it'll make you give even more thanks to the Lord than you could imagine right now. So thank you, Pastor Bobby, for helping us think that direction. I want to share one thing about their church that you need to know. Central Christian Church here in Moberly is really active and looking for help from students like you. They are open to all kinds of things that they can do to minister to this community. I mean, he mentioned the youth football league, and the amount of help they need with that is incredible. Worship at their church, various ways to take care of children. If you're looking for something to feel like you can develop your gifts and be in a body of believers that will notice you and care for you and include you and support you during your time here in Moberly, please go see Pastor Bobby after this service concludes, because he would love to line you up and connect you with the things that they do there at Central Christian Church here in Moberly. It's a great congregation. He's doing a great job leading it, and they're looking for people like you. Hey, we're coming down to just 2.5 weeks left of school, which is exciting and scary. All those in my class that are getting ready to give speeches are closer to the scary side than they are the excited side. But that's okay. They're going to do a great job, and I know you're going to do a great job, too, as you close out the semester. Well, we'll be back for one more chapel next week. I'm looking forward to introducing that guy to you as well. Till then, have a great week, and we'll see you back here next week.
Chase me down.
Seek me out.
How could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down. You seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down. You seek me out. How could I be lost?